Hello everybody and welcome to today's webinar. My name is Michael Francis and I look after the marketing at MediaTek Labs. Today's presenter is Ed Kay, who is going to take us through power management for IoT devices. So with no further ado, I'm now going to pass over to Ed Kay, who will talk us through all of the things you need to think about from a power management point of view when you're developing or designing an IoT device.
Thanks, Michael, and happy birthday. Hi, everybody. Great to be back with you again. This is a presentation where we'll highlight some of the areas to look at. In particular, this month, it's going to be basically looking at IoT power management. We have had a few webinars in the past where we started to look at the whole process from going through your idea to prototyping and then on to a product. And that's actually the real aim of MediaTek Labs, is really to help you accelerate and support that route from your idea through to product. For the series that we've been doing, we've been trying to focus on the overview and then drilling into individual parts of that that process, that chain, to highlight where there are areas that we think could be of particular help to have awareness of, maybe in advance of starting to prototype things. I would like to kind of emphasize, this is an interactive and a dynamic webinar series. So if there are any other things that people are having particular challenges with, issues, then we're very happy to wrap them into the roadmap of webinars going forward. So your feedback is appreciated. At the end of the slides, there is a URL that you can use to contact us, and we're very happy to use your future webinars. And just to kind of while I remember, because of this is getting into European summertime now. So we'll be taking a summer break for the next month or two. So we're just going to have a little pause at this point, but that does give you time to consider what's your pain point, what are your challenges, where are you finding barriers, and if you ping those over to us, we'll be happy to incorporate them into another webinar. And in fact, we may well do a State of the Nation as a next webinar to give people an idea of what's trending at the moment, what's important, and maybe bring a few guests in to discuss some of the things that are particularly interesting to developers at the moment. As I said, this month we're talking about power management. So really to kick off, why is MediaTek interested, and why are we interesting? Why should you be interested that MediaTek is in this area? Well, MediaTek has enabled 1.5 billion devices in 2015. So we have a background in various categories, in various verticals, where we deliver value in terms of high performance, low power, highly efficient chipsets, notably in kind of smartphones, tablets, smart TVs, routers, Blu-ray and DVD players, things like that, where we're neither number one or number two a chip provider in the world. So we have a legacy of providing technology into various verticals, and our background has always been moving from kind of low power but highly efficient, high performance chipsets, which really plays well into the IoT space. As you are no doubt aware and have probably seen countless times before, the projected forecasts for IoT engagement over the next few years are staggering. I've got a slide here which actually shows the difference between the projected number of deployed devices in 2020. So Hammersmith Group kind of forecasting 100 billion devices, Alex Partners 21 billion. But I mean, and admittedly, there is a 79 billion difference between those two numbers. But 21 billion is a big number anyway. So all we know is that it's going to be huge. It's likely to be very pervasive, and I think most likely your daily lives will be impacted by IoT devices going forward. MediaTek recognises there are three major challenges to IoT. One of the, we don't recognise power management as a particular problem. It's an opportunity, in our opinion. The three major challenges, just so you're aware, interoperability, there's lots of standards, security. Partially this is a perception issue, people not trusting IoT solutions going forward because of data breaches, hacks, things like that. And also business models. I think many companies are still yet to really get to grips with what's going to be the profit model going forward. And is this something where profits and success is shared out to individual companies, or is it more of an ecosystem play? So these are all challenges that we recognise, and we've discussed some of these in the past. We've certainly discussed security, business model and interoperability. We touched on a little bit when we had the conversation about big data a couple of months ago. All of these webinars, by the way, are available on ShareSlide and YouTube channels. Again, I'll mention that at the end. So there's lots of things, lots of challenges. However, if you look at this slide, there are lots of successes already in the market. And many of you will have some of these devices already. Smart speakers, for instance. We have here things like trackers, IoT bridges, smartwatches, sensors, smartphones, kettles, you know, lots of different things, phone accessories, that sort of stuff. And MediaTek is in many of these devices. So why is power management important? I mean, many of you may think of it as, you know, it's a necessary evil. I've got to make sure that the device that I'm building can last long enough to deliver what I want. And that's absolutely true. One of the things that we obviously need to take into account is what are the available sources of power? Is it something that you're wearing on your wrist, in which case you're not going to be next to an ongoing power supply, rather that's going to have to be battery operated? Is it something that's in the home that could be run off a main supply? So there's a number of things, and it's an interesting challenge because, as you can see, the IoT landscape is very, very wide. There's lots of verticals. You know, we've listed six, but you can cut it in many different ways. And there are some horizontals that cut right through the middle of this. So wearables, for instance, is in a number of vertical segments. So it's not really a vertical itself, it just cuts through them. But as you can see, as you've got all these different verticals, all these different solutions within verticals, you're going to have a number of devices that are sensing things, so each of these solutions has multiple sensors. So what we're doing is we're multiplying verticals by a number of solutions, by devices, by sensors, and that number becomes extremely large. And as you can appreciate, if you start to, you know, even if you've got an unlimited power supply, you can't just keep adding more and more devices to drain the power. At some point, there's going to be a breaking point. So with this in mind, power management is absolutely crucial. Car manufacturers, they consider it very important to understand the power management capabilities of the devices they're deploying within the car. And you might say, well, cars have got, you know, they've got their big battery, they've got lots of juice to keep things going. But if you add more and more devices to it, that becomes a dwindling resource. Even more so when you talk about electric cars in the future. You look at Tesla cars, they have a stated range, but that range changes depending on what other electrical devices you switch on in the car. You start turning on air conditioning, sat nav, lighting, entertainment systems, and suddenly that range starts to decrease. So it's really crucial to consider that power management is important in almost every case. And, you know, it may well even come down to a purely monetary reason. At home, if you're running smart hubs, infotainment systems and things like that, if they're all very power hungry, that's fine. You obviously won't run out of power at home. But when you get your monthly bill, then you'll probably need to consider how much money you're spending. And that's not to even talk about the green factor here, you know, that we're all striving to be a little bit more greener. Every little bit helps. So I think, you know, to some people, power management is has never been on their radar because they don't consider that their home-based or office building-based device has any kind of issue in drawing power. But I would argue that actually it's worth considering and very much could be a differentiator between you and your customers in the future. Now, obviously it's not the only important thing. Security is an important factor as well. But I would stress that even if you think the scenario doesn't require careful power management, it probably does in reality. Not just for efficiency, but for the cost of use of maintenance and drawing power from other things as well. So don't really just consider it to be an issue for things like smartwatches and smartphones. They tend to be more obvious because you have to go and find a socket and plug them in at some point, as I'm sure all of us have. And as you can see, I mean, the range of IoT devices, it spreads with indoor, outdoor, wearables, smart home, office, machine to machine. So some of these devices will be deployed, could be remotely, might be battery powered, but often with the intention that there's little or no human interaction for a long time. So to be to be efficient with power, to make sure people don't need to come and replace batteries every so often, is really kind of in terms of feature set, it's a big win. MediaTek, why is MediaTek interested and why should you be concerned that MediaTek is talking about this? We have a legacy of low power. A lot of our devices started in the low end of the market, smartphones and things like that. So our legacy and our expertise is in low power, small footprint solutions. A lot of the devices we have at the moment have got class-leading power capabilities, but we've also been using kind of multi-mode options to provide additional capabilities for developers. I'll come onto those in a bit, but essentially they can have benefits in terms of improving power consumption while remaining very responsive and giving you a good user interface experience. We've continued our focus on low power high performance and new system on chip, which I'll come on to, 2523 and 7687, both have power management units built in as hardware, and that gives you access to quite an extensive power management capability. So you can really look at your use cases, your the way that your devices are going to be operated in the future, and you can kind of start to identify where there are efficiencies to be made, how you can transition between working modes, things like that. So how do we identify power saving opportunities? Well, really you kind of need to look at the device you're building, identify the possible behaviours. We sometimes use use case modelling in this, where we look at how devices are operated in various modes. And it's also worth thinking about in this instance, not just how they operate in various modes, but how they transition from one mode to another. So if it's a case of your device being in sleep mode, and you wake it up and you want to use it, but you need to wake it up and be responsive instantly, then there are various kind of power saving modes that will allow you to fire up very quickly.
rather than waiting 2 or 3 seconds for everything to boot up and get going. So it's worth knowing and understanding all the different power modes and how they can affect the use case and the typical kind of usage of your customers. These also give you areas where you can compromise. So sometimes a startup from off to on might be a compromise where you can take a few more seconds, whereas going from sleep to responsive might need to be immediate. So you can look at some of these areas, and it's worth, as I said, understanding what the power modes will bring as to how you can compromise between what's an acceptable behavior and what's going to give you the best power or battery management. In terms of power mode flows, really, as I said, one of the challenges there is to understand when you transition from one mode to another, what the benefits are, what the startup speeds need to be, how responsive it needs to be as soon as you switch from one thing to another. And also, one of the things that's worth thinking about as well in this context is your connectivity systems. I've put a little table there of a few of the popular connectivity protocols. And you can see that there's a few of them. Wi-Fi, obviously Wi-Fi, very high power usage. So if you're running on battery and you're on Wi-Fi, you kind of need to have a look at your use case. Does it need to be always on? Are you sending data all the time? Does it need to be that responsive? The bandwidth required for that? So there's a number of areas where you can always look to compromise or look to achieve acceptable performance while still managing to keep an eye on the power management side of things. And this goes right across all the verticals. Obviously, it's the most acutely felt in wearables because, as I mentioned, you don't want to be walking around trying to plug your smartwatch into a power socket every half an hour. You kind of want a day's acceptable use out of a device, I guess. Obviously, more. Some of us remember the old days when you could have a smartphone that would last a week on a single charge. But equally, you know, some other verticals, you know, the utilities industry, transportation, they may have a different priority. So you compromise based on the priorities within your customer requirements. I talked a little bit about power operation modes. I won't go into a huge amount of technical detail, but really this is to highlight that you have various kind of modes where you can turn devices completely off or into sleep mode or even deep sleep mode, and then you maybe have other modes where you're running a normal speed and maybe can even go to high speed as well. And some of the areas that you need to consider there will be, do you need that speed in terms of data acquisition, in terms of connectivity, processing, things like that, against the power that they're drawing. And it can be quite a significant difference. The other side of it, which I have mentioned already, is that moving between the various modes can be slower or faster depending on what the power saving capabilities are. And if that's a critical value, then that can also be a deciding factor as to which mode you should be entering. You know, deep sleep mode obviously is longer to get out of than, say, sleep mode or low speed mode. So thinking about those things and having a look at the data tables when you come to selecting chipsets becomes a crucial thing. And it can make the difference between a product, you know, just being smooth, operating as you expect, or that whole kind of having something, I don't know, something on your wrist maybe that you click on and then you have to wait a few seconds for it to start up. Which, when you talk about it in this context, doesn't sound bad, but when you're standing there waiting for your smartwatch to fire up and it's taking 5 seconds, it doesn't set a good expectation. So definitely worth considering these things. With that in mind, there are two new offerings from MediaTek. We have the MT2523 and the MT7687. The 2523 is the first full-featured system-on-chip for wearables. Has a GPS version. It is the world's first Cortex M4 with floating point smartwatch. As I mentioned before, it has a power management unit, Bluetooth, so you've got low-energy Bluetooth. It has a very low-power GNSS capabilities, so your satellite capabilities are well covered, and it can support MCU rich user interface support as well. It's really a smartwatch system on chip. However, we have seen people who have been using it in other areas. Essentially, it's a wearable device, and so it gives you that benefit of a small portable device with a GNSS capability. The power management unit really does help you to manage the mode better, and obviously low energy Bluetooth for connectivity. As a smartwatch, it's actually a great chip. But equally, if you're making smart glasses, then it's probably a very good chip to consider as well. A few of the technical considerations for this chip. I won't go through this in massive detail. Main thing to point out, it's an ARM Cortex M4 with floating point MCU, 208 megahertz, as I said, the PMU is in hardware, so you can handle the power management a lot better. And it has GNSS support for all the major protocols, so GPS, GLONASS, Galileo, and Beta. So really future-proofing itself. That I will point out, that is for the G variant of the chip. We do chip variant without the GNSS as well. In terms of smart home, we have the sensor 687. And there's a number of different use cases that this is most suitable for. Home appliances are a really obvious choice here, and smart gadgets, so things within the home. It's got support for things like HomeKit, Apple HomeKit, JD.com, things like that. Again, it's an ARM Cortex M4 with floating point, running at 192 megahertz. The PMU is embedded again, and it has also a very extensive Wi-Fi subsystem. That's been specifically designed to be power efficient. So again, we've always got that idea of really kind of doing the most with the most amount of power. Underlying all this is the MediaTek LinkIt development platform for RTOS. This really is to allow multiple solutions to be built based on the Cortex M4 architecture. It's a common SDK, so you should be able to build solutions and have familiar and common capabilities across multiple devices, multiple solutions. As you can see, we've got the architectural layout there. It's got integration already to some protocols, some networking connectivity protocols. And we've supported development in the Keil and GCC toolsets. So it kind of covers both the slightly more costly professional Keil tools and also the GNU toolchain. So really trying to cover all the bases. And it's lots of open source capabilities as well. So very powerful, very open, and able for people to build on the free RTOS, which is relatively common. I won't dwell on this slide too much. It's the actual architecture of the SDK. You can see that most of the things are covered there, and you can work on all the stuff that's relevant for you. Obviously, covering Wi-Fi, Bluetooth, if your chip doesn't support part of that, you don't need to use that. But as you can see, just to kind of go back to the power management side of things, battery management is part of the architecture as well. So you've got access already deeply into supporting various power management modes. So really, it's worth considering that. It gives you access that hitherto hadn't been available on these sort of resources. So the open source modules, as I mentioned, the common SDK, which allows you to now build against a single tool chain going forward. And we have the runline tools as well as Keil support for development and debugging. The two hardware development kits which are coming soon are the 7687 HDK by SAC and the 2523 HDK by SAC. As I've already mentioned, the 2523 one is much more wearables and mobile IoT devices, has Bluetooth, dual mode Bluetooth, very low power consumption, very small footprint, and the GNSS solution gives you higher accuracy positioning if that's the version that you require. The sensor KTA for home automation and things like that, focus on power efficiency, even though you may have this plugged into the mains, it's still worth being power efficient. And secure Wi-Fi, so it's got security engines built in as well. So some of the design considerations, well, we support a lot of standards. I've got a list of standards that are supported here. And, you know, you need to kind of have a look at what standards work for you. Things like Thread or HomeKit, USB, cellular, Wi-Fi. These are all decisions that you need to take based on usage case and things like power management. And often, sometimes, security may well also be a contributing factor to that. But of all those standards, some are supported, some are not. There are a set of requirements that you need to apply that will define what standard you address. User privacy is a big one. Long battery life. That's an absolutely critical one. And as I mentioned before, if you've got devices that are out in the field and shouldn't have much human interaction, then making sure that they're running as long as they need to is a critical thing and should probably be number one and number two on your requirements list. There's a few other things there. This is actually quite a good list for you to use when you're creating your ideas for the first time and you're building up your requirements plan. It's good to have a kind of a checklist to say what we need to address in terms of privacy, security, battery life, user friendliness, all these sort of things. Some of them are at odds with each other. You can't be running your CPU flat out with full Wi-Fi on all the time and expect to have long battery life. There are going to be some areas where you're going to butt into each other and start to have to compromise. But this gives you a good list where you can start to do that. Just a slide. This is, to be honest, this is a bit of a follow-on from last month's webinar where we talked about IoT security. So security at the moment for the 7687 2523. So we have a hardware root for secure boot, firmware updates, device unique hardware ID and keys. So we're really trying to stop the cloning side of things. Support for unique customer keys, JTAG support for debugging, and AES encryption algorithms. And then some support for some protocols like HomeKit, things like that. So you can see we've really kind of started to consider a lot of the security implications and trying to build in as many opportunities and convenient kind of touch points for you to start to address security. I know it's one of the hot topics. Many of the conferences I've been to recently, it comes up so often. And there's lots of pessimism around it. But I think if we start to make it as a primary consideration, and MediaTek hopefully can help with that by putting it as basic hardware functions, then I think that it's hopefully you can resolve the hardware security considerations against your user interface expectations. So that's been a quick zoom through IoT power management. Really, the purpose of this presentation wasn't to deep dive into the tiniest minute details on power management, but really to highlight that it's an important issue, not just for devices that you're wearing or are walking around with, like your phones or anything, which are the traditionally kind of focused areas, but you should really especially consider it for other things. In the future, I was at a conference this week, and someone predicted in 10 years' time that they would expect between 50 and 500 connected devices to be in everybody's house. Now, if you think about that context, if you've got 500 connected devices in your house, all drawing lots of power, then A, your monthly bill will be terrifying, and B, the amount of power that we're all going to increase on our national grids is going to be enormous. So unless there's a sudden upsurge in our ability to generate more power, nuclear fusion, fission, renewables, whatever, then we're really going to have to start to be more efficient about what we're using. So power usage considerations are critical, not just for wearables, and not just for operating life as well. So, the lifetime of your device when it's operating, that is obviously a critical thing. But bearing in mind that the transitions between various user modes can also have a critical effect on the general kind of user friendliness and user interface of your device, which, could be the difference between whether your product sells or whether it doesn't. MediaTek really does have a focus on power efficient, highly integrated and cost effective system on chip solutions. So I highlighted two of the new ones here, but in general it's something that underlines what MediaTek is about. It's in our kind of DNA that we look at power efficiency and cost effectiveness. So we're really always trying to strive for that perfect balance of performance and power management. And MediaTek has been doing a lot of work around IoT. As I said, we've enabled 1.5 billion devices last year, and so our customers are already delivering IoT products into the market. So we have that legacy. We're very experienced in doing it. You've probably got MediaTek chips in your devices at home. We're really ready and willing to help with your solutions going forward. What are the next steps? First one is very easy and free. Register at labs.mediatek.com. I imagine or hope that most of you already have registered at Labs. This gives you access to all the SDKs free, and also the pretty vibrant forums, where there's a real sense of peer-to-peer communication and helping each other. And you find many answers have already been asked and maybe resolved by people who are just dabbling around and working with their own IoT solutions. It's very kind of altruistic. The webinar content is available on YouTube and SlideShare. This webinar will go up there as soon as we can get it up there. That does include previous webinars and some of those have been things around security, which was last month, an interesting one on big data, the value of big data, and the benefits of ecosystem support. MediaTek Labs, we're really strong believers in the value of the ecosystem, how we can help support that. You know, we have things like Partner Connect program, which allows helps us to connect developers with large-scale industrial design and manufacturing capabilities, and really accelerates time to market. So there's a lot of things that we can kind of do to add value to the ecosystem. And if you've got any questions or any feedback or any subjects you'd like us to talk about in the future, then if you contact us at lab.mediatek.com/contact us, then we'll definitely want to hear your thoughts, and hopefully we can add more webinars in to target specific things that you're interested in. As I said, we'll be taking maybe a couple of months summer holiday now. We'll need a bit of a rest and recuperation in the summer. So I think that we'll be announcing the next one through the usual channels, probably maybe September time. So hopefully this has been useful. Hopefully it's kind of raised some thoughts around power management. And be lovely to hear from you on your thoughts. And if there's things that you want to ask now, that's absolutely fine. We've got the WebEx system running, so if you're typing any questions in, Michael will be able to pick them up. But yeah, thanks for your time.
Thank you very much, Ed. That was really interesting overview of everything you need to start thinking about with power management. As Ed mentioned, with more and more devices using power, then we need to start thinking about it. It's simple as that. And so if anyone has any questions at all, we've got a couple in from Martin Sinlastic. Thank you, Martin. We'll answer those now. Please do type them into your WebEx panel. We've got plenty of time, so don't be shy. So the first question from Martin, which was when I think Ed was talking about the MT2523 chip, is can you elaborate a little bit on the accuracy of the built-in GNSS and also comment on its sensitivity, etc.?
We do have some information on that, but I can't share it directly. I think we'd have to have a more private conversation around those sort of things. Obviously we have good data on that. I would just have to check that information can be given out with or without an NDA, so I just need to confirm that. We have customers using that, and once we have NDAs in place, we can actually share quite a lot of data around the performance of the various chips.
Thanks, Ed. So Martin, I think if you drop us a line on the in the contact us page, then we can take that further. And another question from Martin is, what is the YouTube channel? So I think the easiest way to find it, if you look on labs.mediatek.com, then at the footer we have links to all of our social media channels. So the channel is actually called MediaTek Lab, but if you just go on the Labs website and click the YouTube link at the bottom, then you'll find them. There's videos on all of these webinars. There's also a lot of technical tutorials as well. So it's not marketing or sales content. It's very much technical content aimed at developers. So it's actually really useful. So please do take a look at that this video and other videos as well. Great. So we have another question from Omar Killick, who's talking about the 7687 chip, and he's again is asking how low power are we talking about, and any target date for a data sheet release. So I think Ed, the answer is pretty much the same on that one.
Unfortunately, yeah, I think we'd need to for any kind of detailed data sheets, we can talk about NDAs, and I can give you that information. We don't normally share that kind of that information, these sorts of, you know, sort of publicly, but yeah, I mean that information is available, so
if you contact us through the URL, then we can maybe share some more information. And equally, I think what I will try and do is find out when the data sheets will be publicly available, so I can talk to the technical teams. And if I get an answer within the next few hours, then I think I can maybe add it to the slides, and then we can publish that as part of the slide deck.
Thanks, Ed. So Emma's coming back saying he's happy to sign that NDA. What's the best way to contact us? So,
if you go through the contact us site, then that will give me some your email address and things like that. I can follow up then. Obviously, we just to give everyone a bit of an insight. So what we do is we don't obviously sign NDAs with every single person. That would be ridiculous. So what we do is we make introductions. We get to know a little bit about you, what projects you're working on, things like volumes that you expect, stuff like that. And then you know, we don't want to inflict NDAs on people if we don't have to. And much of the work you can do without NDAs in place. But when there's things like certain data sheets and stuff like that, then that might be more appropriate for NDAs.
Thanks, Ed. So just to be clear, the contact us page, if you go on labs.mediatek.com, and then in the top nav about labs, and the contact us is under that drop down. So if you just put just your details in there, and we can take it from there. So that's all the questions we have at the moment into the WebEx panel. So just give it another minute if anyone else has got any questions. So thank you for the feedback from Bastian, who's thanked Ed for the presentation. So I'd also like to thank Ed for the presentation. I think that was very interesting today.
Thanks, guys. It was a pleasure to talk. All right. As I said, we have a number of technical webinars. What this series of webinars is more about is highlighting specific areas of challenge that sometimes even experienced people, you talk to them and they haven't thought about things like security or power management or even big data. And they're such hot topics and interesting conversations that we felt it was good to raise their awareness, even if it just means you're thinking about it as part of your plan. Even if you dismiss the idea and it's not important to you, you've got it on your roadmap as something to be aware of in the future. And as I said, I mean, we'll probably look to bring in a few experts in a future webinar and maybe talk about various things in one session just to kind of bring everyone back up to speed, perhaps after the summer, and maybe talk about big data security, power management, and maybe a few other kind of trending topics.